Ramchandra K to deliver his valuable lecture for us. Over to Dr. Ramchandra, sir.
Sir, thank you very much for accepting our invitation and coming online for us.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible to you?
Yeah.
Okay, am I visible? And my presentation is visible to sir?
Yeah, it is visible, sir. And two other resource persons are also online with us.
Great to hear that. Yes. So I'm going to continue my session.
Sure,
so at the outset, I thank the organizers of Principal Madam Anita, Dr. V. Anita Ananta Lakshmi Garu, and then co-chairman for this webinar, Sri Kumari Y. Padmaja Madam Garu, and convener Vijay Kumar Garu, co-convener and good friend Elia Bandari Garu, and the organizing secretary, Mrs. M. Surekha Garu, and other organizing members, and who is introduced me now, Mrs. K. N. V. S. N. Ishwari Madam Garu. So, really, I am very happy to be associated with this wonderful webinar is organizing by Women Degree College, Pitapuram. As rightly pointed out by our good friend, Dr. Anil Kumar Garu, so COVID made us to incline towards, technology. So that means all our government college lecturers now, technology enabled teachers now. So, and then see, once upon a time, if you want to conduct a seminar or webinar, seminar or workshop or conference, it's a big job. So one, that means the committee has to strive to get the permissions and this thing, that thing, contact the people, and then at least, so 3 to 6 months of, pre-conference proceedings works are there. And then post-conference proceedings, so many things are there during webinars, but during seminars and workshops. But nowadays, it becomes easy. And then in a small college like, Pitapuram College also came forward and attracts the outside world people. That means the Kuwait and all other state participants, they participated in this.
Okay.
Yeah.
We are controlling, sir. We are controlling.
Yes. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay. So it is really a great thing. Definitely, my heartfelt appreciations and greetings to all the organizing committee of Government Degree College, Pitapuram, and also chosen me as a speaker of today's webinar. And then now, let me go for my topic today, and advanced energy materials for environmental applications. So this is actually, this work already Dr. Elia Bandari has pointed out, and then I got Raman Fellowship as a government college lecturer. And then I went US University of Lowell. I did one extraordinary work, and it is very impressive work actually. So during that tenure, I utilized my entire time and dedicated towards the advanced energy materials, how these materials, advanced energy materials, to apply for environmental applications, and what are the main problem in our environment, how we get a clean and a green environment. For that, what the role of scientists and what the role of research. So these things they did, and that means they are doing there. So I really fascinated to know these advanced energy materials and their applications towards the environment. So I really excited when I go there, and then I worked on that the same work I would like to present you now. And it is really, really, definitely, it's exciting thing. That means the research, how the environment research is going on with advanced energy materials. Yes. Let me go for, I would like to address you. I would like to go for one problem actually. So it is when you are seeing at my slide, then we all know that when you are going through the paper and other Google browse, then there is a one thing, when you are looking for the environmental issues and all, so you come across definitely Paris Climate Agreement. So what is Paris? What is this Paris Climate Agreement? So that means the United Nations framework convergence for this climate change. So the agreement is like this. The agreement sets out a global action plan to put the world on track to avoid dangerous climate changes by limiting global warming to well below 2 degrees centigrade. So see here, in your slide, in the entire slide, one eye catch point is there when you are looking at this is, here it is, 2 degrees Celsius. So that means there, when you are looking at the underlined part, 2 degrees Celsius could decide our fate. Really, is it? Definitely, 2 degrees centigrade Celsius could decide our fate means, yeah, all over, on average, global temperature, if it rises to 2 degrees temperature, almost all what we are seeing, what existing on this blue planet, some of the islands, they are going to disappear. Maldives and then Sri Lanka, these kind of some areas, almost all they are going to disappear in the world map. So that means what is the reason for this? So that means on average, the global temperature, if it rises 2 degrees Celsius, then almost what is going to be happen? So that means the greenhouse gases and the atmosphere temperature is increases, so that all snow is going to be melt. So whenever it melts, then the sea level is going to rise. If the sea level rises, then almost all the one beautiful islands, they are going to disappear. So this is a hurdle which we are going to face in future. So because then now you may heard like this. So in ancient people, our grandparents, our grandma, so they are telling that the climate is very cool, and then they are very strong. They don't have any problems like BP, sugar, or like that, because they had very strong food. At the same time, they have clean and green environment. So nowadays, you can see there is no clean environment. So many CO2 gases and CO gases are there. Many effluents from the factories, and this all made us to go for higher temperatures in the atmosphere. So that means high temperature. Previously, when you are looking at ancient days, the maximum temperature 35 degrees, below 40 degrees. Now, so when we got the summer, then you couldn't expect what kind of temperature we are going to have. So that means the sun is roaring almost all. We are reaching the temperature nearly 46, 47, sometimes 50 also. So that's a dangerous thing, actually. So that means the reasons for this. So that means the world, academicians and politicians and then administrators and then scientists, all the researchers had to think. So that thinking outcome is this Paris Climate Agreement. It is everybody's responsibility on this blue planet. We have to control the climate and we have to reduce the temperature. For that, each and every country has to take some resolutions, and then we have to avoid this CO2 gases which are going into the environment, that is going to make a big hurdle to the humans. So this kind of things are there. So that means that's why there is a Paris Climate Agreement. So this agreement sets out a global action plan. So that's the reason. This is a global action plan to put the world on track to avoid dangerous gases, climate changes. So when we are reaching above 2 degrees temperature, almost all dangerous gases and the things what we are going to get, this hurdle. How can we overcome this hurdle? That is the point here. And then what is the research role to control this 2 degrees of temperature on global temperature? So this is the thing. And then that's why, can we control the main reason for this increasing of 2 degrees temperature means CO2 gases are going to be increased year by year in the atmosphere. That is one of the main hurdles. The scientists found that. So the reason to rise the temperature in the environment is excess of CO2 in the environment. So that means William Noether. So can we control carbon dioxide? So what is the role of your research? And what is the role of scientists? What is the role of politicians and these things, administrators? So this way, this problem, you have to think out very loudly. So you have to address this problem. So this environment problem. So what? How can we address this problem? So when you go for the statistics, so that means, see, when the CO2 levels in the atmosphere, when you look at this slide, you come across, you know, in 1950s and below, then the PPT, PPM, particle per million, the CO2 level is almost all very less. Okay, now we are going to have almost all, it is going to be increased like this. Okay, so now we are in 2020, 2050, then you just imagine how much PPM is there here, almost all 600. So that's very dangerous. Now, in 2006, 409.28 PPM. So that means here, when you are looking at the statistics, it is increasing year by year. So that means the CO2 production rate is increasing. So that means you understand how it is increasing, means vehicular pollution and the, you know, industrial revolution, that means industry and then some, you know, plastic, many things are responsible for this CO2 emission. That means ACs, you know, greenhouse gases which are going into the environment, many things are there. So because of all these reasons, the CO2 levels are increasing. So now it is in increasing mode. Well, we had to think on this and we had to take certain measures to control this. So that means we had to take some minimize. See, you just understand. So these are, this is the below 400, it is safe. Okay. And then now already we crossed that safe point here. Now it is going up 500 and 600. So really it is unbearable. And automatically the adverse effects is going to come to from the environment. And finally, the human beings are the sufferers. Okay, already we are suffering with the COVID-19. And then, so that means in future, you may have this kind of environmental issues are also there. So that means what is the role of this researchers and scientists here? So this is actually the US people and all advanced country people, they are thinking on it and they are investing billions of crores of rupees on this particular environmental issues. Okay, so see, let me go for what is the solution? How can we minimize the CO2? Okay. Then the next target is CO2. So this is our environmental problem. And then how this advanced material, how the physics. So that means the physics is a subject and which is a royal subject. And how this problem is going to address by the scientists, means physicists or chemists and our other environmentalists. Okay, so our main, the target is the CO2. So,
sir, could you please take that mic to close now, sir?
To us, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
The main thing is CO2 here. And then now, let me go for how can we break this CO2? And then the technology, how the technology is looking at the CO2. That means the technology is behind this CO2 problem. How can we break the CO2 molecule in the atmosphere? If you break the CO2 molecule and then you can get some products, if you do some research on this and some scientific methods, if you apply on the CO2 molecule, and then definitely the CO2 may be break and we can convert the CO2 into a useful chemicals. So that is the research. So how can we break the CO2 molecule and all these things? That is the science. Now I am going to explain you that. Okay, then now let me go for the next thing. So the search for the solution. So that means the problem I already explained you now. So that means the excess of CO2 presence in the environment, that is going to be a big hurdle for the human beings. So we need a clean and green environment, and it is our responsibility to give the clean and green environment for the next generation, so to our kids. Okay, so that is, what is the solution for this? So what the scientists are there doing on this means, so the prime thing is, we have to break the CO2 molecule, and that has to be converted into a useful chemicals. That is a one of the way. So the next one is, how can we break the CO2 molecule? So the next question, and then search for the solution. The solution is, now this is one slide which I am going to tell you. This may be the solution. So what is this? 0.1 meter is, you are seeing orange, okay? So the size of this is 0.1 meter. And then now, let me go for the thing. Suppose our globe size is, suppose 0.12, if you rise this 10 power 8 times, then so nearly 10 power 7 meters is our size of our blue planet. Okay, it is our responsibility to protect this blue planet. To protect this blue planet by utilizing a small invisible materials or nanomaterials. So that means by using this nanomaterial, we have to target this. Yeah. We have to target like this. That is the solution.
I request the participants to please mute your audio.
Understand, dear participants, what I'm trying to tell you. So our globe size is 10 power 8. If you go upper conversion and lower conversion, if you bring down that conversion, so that is 10 to the power of minus 9, 1 nanometer length. So that means 1 nanometer length particles and that materials, they can give you the solution to protect our blue planet. To protect our blue planet. So that's the thing which I am going to tell you. So by taking the advantage of nanomaterials, and we can prepare advanced energy materials by using the properties of nanomaterials or nanoform. And these materials are being used to give, to convert these CO2 molecules into useful chemicals. Okay, so that is the thing. That means, so how the scientists they are doing this particular thing. So I guess you understood the intents behind this slide is, I want to sensitize to protect our blue planet from serious hurdles, and then we can make use of this particular nanomaterials, and then looking for some solutions to sort out the environmental problem. Okay, so let me go for the next slide. Is, yeah, so that means, you know, all over the globe, all the research scientists, all the, that means academicians also, they are very much interested towards the nanoscience and technology because it's really exciting. So that means it is my responsibility to tell you, and as well as students and the staff members who are present in this particular webinar, I would like to show you some of the exciting things in relating with the nanoscience and technology, one or two slides, and then I wanna go for other, the real content. So this is a self-cleaning ultra-hydrophobicity. See, I really wondered when I'm looking at this, why this water drop is not sticking to this particular, you know, lotus leaf. See, this is because of nanoscience, and then the materials which they form in the nanoform, and the surface area is more and more comparing with the volume ratio. These are the things. So it is one of the beautiful example of nanotechnology. And then now the next thing is, you just look at this, how this things will be formed in this. Okay, self-cleaning technology. So that is possible with a nanoscience. And let me tell you one more important and exciting thing. See, the sensory cells in the of the inner ear. Suppose in our ear, when you are looking this particular thing under TEM, advanced transmission electron microscope, and then you may have this the cells, they're arranged like this. These cells has different. These cells has different. These cells has different lengths. So these different lengths will responsible for the different frequency. That's why we are able to hear from small to bigger sounds. Okay, so these are the extremely sensitive. We could not see them with the naked eye. So these are all in the form of nanometer size. So like these beautiful examples are there. Any known examples are there. See, I would like to tell you one thing here. So this means, peacocks and then beautiful butterflies. They are, when you are looking them, they are very beautiful. The design. And then when they're flying, very attractive. So that means how beautiful they are. That means the flyers, when you are looking at them, they're very clean and neat. So that, do you think that this, peacocks and their butterflies, they are doing everyday bath and like us, they are, do they take, some kind of, face creams and all other cleaning materials? Nothing. So that means that particular, the feathers, they are made with this nanomaterials. So the nanomaterials means because of that size and then larger surface area and then close packing, then no dust particle is sticking into that. And then simply, so if they flip like this, then automatically all the dust particle which they fall on particular feathers, they automatically they go away. So this is all, that means we do not know all these things, but still these are the facts which we can see in the environment. So that means these nanomaterials and nanoparticles are the one of the best solutions to break that CO2 molecule. Okay, then now let me go for the beautiful quantum mechanical example here. So whenever I am trying to give you the talk on this nanomaterial, it is my favorite slide to explain to my all colleagues and as well as students who are presenting here. So that means the beauty of quantum mechanics when you are looking at, so why this nanoparticles has such a great importance? All the scientists, they are fascinating to do this nanoscience and technology research. Because this is the one point where you had to think on this. So this is the particle in a box. So as per the Schrodinger wave equation, so the application of Schrodinger equation is particle in a box. So that means in a particular box, then the length of the box is L. If you put a particular particle in that length, a small length, box, and then the walls may be infinite. For suppose if you give some amount of energy, then what is the energy of that particle which is having a small length? So that means the particle size is a boss. Particle size should be a size of your box. If you think like that, then at the end, if you solve that Schrodinger equation by applying certain boundary conditions, then you have this beautiful equation at the end. So what this equation is telling you is that, so simply here there are five parameters. One is energy, and another is h-cut, and pi, and m, and l. So all these simply, h-cut is, h by 2 pi, that you know it well. H is a Planck's constant. Pi is a 22 by 7, that is a constant. 2 is constant. M, mass of the particular thing is also a constant. And what other things are not constant and means variables. Here it is energy and length. So when you are this, keep aside of all these constant part and energy and length, when you are considering it, the energy is inversely proportional to its length. So that is the thing which you can take. Energy is inversely proportional to length means if the length is reduced, the length of the particle is reduced, that means the size is reduced. That means from bulk to nano. So bulk to bulk means macro, macro to micro, micro to nano. If you bring down like that, then the energy is going to be increased. So length is decreasing, the energy is increasing. If energy is increasing, then almost all the properties, mechanical, optical, thermal, chemical, electrical, magnetic, every property is going to be changed, and those properties are highly excited. You can do anything and everything with these high energized particles. So that is the thing actually. Okay, so taking advantage of this particular nanomaterials, and their size is also very important. The size is important. The size is a matter here. So that's why nano means why the different nanoparticles having different energies they're going to give out. Okay, so when you look at this, do you think that these are all the different kinds of nanomaterials which gives the different colors? No, they are the same materials, but they are different in their sizes. So that means the same material which gives out you pink color and red color and yellow color and green color and these things. The same material, how it gives you the different colors. That means different absorption are there. Different absorption, how they get it. So by different sizes. Different sizes means different energy. So that means, first suppose you take here, it is a 250 nanometer. Here it is 300 nanometer. Here is 400 nanometer. So that means different nanometers, absorption will be different. By that, you are getting your different energies, different colors, different thing. So then now, let me go for one more thing here. Here, tunable optical, when you are looking at this, tunable optical properties of hollow gold nanospheres. Here it is, hollow gold nanospheres. See, the hollow gold nanospheres, they are forming with different diameters. So that means different thicknesses they are forming. So 44 to 24. So different nanometer scale lengths when you examine this different shell diameter of hollow gold nanospheres through your UV visible, a simple UV visible spectrometer. In my laboratory, also that is there, a UV spectrometer, UV visible spectrometer. It's nearly a 3 lakh to 5 lakh instrument. So that means different, if you are able to prepare different sizes of gold nanospheres, and then you have, see, the absorption here. So nearly, what is your nanometer wavelength here? Different sizes. So 24 size of nanoparticle, nearly it absorbs 500 nanometer wavelength than you have here. So when you are looking at 44 size of the nanometer, automatically it takes, it gives out you the absorption spectra at 800 nanometer length. So that means in between different sizes, you have different colors. So because from 500 to 800, this is a visible spectrum, and then there's a visible absorptions you can take out. So like that, the solution they prepared out of that, that means they exposed this UV light on this, then automatically you will have different colors. So this is the advantage of nanomaterials. So hello, gold nanoparticles. So that's the reason. So previously, when you are going for buying some gold in any gold shop, then previously you have gold means only gold. Nowadays, when you go for the shop, then they are showing you like antique gold, green gold, rose gold, red gold. In gold, different colors. That is possible with different sizes they are preparing, and by that they are absorbing different wavelengths of light, and it will give you different color. Okay, so that is the thing. This is really exciting about the properties of nanomaterial. I would like to show you the experiment of this particular quantum dots. Quantum dots means nearly below 10 nanometers, 1 to 10 nanometer of size of particles, if you are able to prepare, then here it is a quantum dots of Kohrschel nanoparticles. So inner part, they are preparing, cadmium silicate, and then outer part, they are zinc sulfide. So they prepared the gold cadmium sulfate with the zinc sulfide within the range of 1 to 10 nanometer of size. And then the Bayer's Technology Services, they did a wonderful experiment with this particular material, which is size in from the range of the nanoparticle, 1 to 10 nanometer size. So see, look at this, and then how you are going to have, 2.5 nanometer of size of nanoparticle will give you green color. And then next 3.8 nanometer, yellow color. Okay, the next one, when you look at this, 5 nanometer particle size give you, absorbs, what is that? Red color. So that means different sizes will have different absorption strengths. So taking advantage of this nanotechnology, the scientists like physicists, chemists, biologists, environmentalists, engineers, almost all the scientific community, they are make use of these particular nanomaterials in their domain applications. So that you have to understand it. Okay, and then now let me go for, so I want to tell you finally, the nanotechnology and nanoscience is not restricted to one field. So it is, you name it and have it, particular applications. Like you go for chemistry, and now we are thinking about, now this webinar is mainly environment technologies and all. So this is chemistry, environment, catalysis, fuel cells, sensors, paints, almost all, So like material science, lightweight materials, alloys, nanocomposites, wear resistance coating, super plasticity, super hardness material, packing materials and all. And electronics, chips, magnetism, optoelectronics, high speed optical communications, actuators, screens, displays, data transmissions. Okay. And then biology also, cancer applications, biosensors, cosmetics, tissue engineering, biomolecular machines and all. So you just name it and have it, the application of this particular nanomaterials and nano science and technology. So I will tell you one beautiful example. Very recently I came across, and in internet also that is there. So previously when we buy a car, so then in a family, I like white color, my wife like red color, my kids like blue color, and my mother and father like some other yellow color or like that. See, one color. So as a head of the family, he is going to buy only one car. But in a family, all the members, they have different opinions on the color of the car. So how can we satisfied for all these family members? So the nanotechnology is going to give you one solution. So that means the paint, nano paints are there. So that means the paint means a different size of particles are there, the nano size of particles they are putting it. And then one UV light they are focusing from the inner part. And then just by knobbing, by tuning the knob, and then you have, suppose today you want to have a white color, you can have white color. And the same color, the body, all the color is going to be changed by turning the knob, yellow color, green color core, and red color core, almost all the colors, Vibzia, how many colors are there, the same colors you can have in your car. Okay, so now, and also one more thing is previously the core means whenever you go to the tropic and then it may get some scratches. So then that is also very big thing. When you buy a new car and then it gets scratches, then we feel a lot, you know. This is nanotechnology, so this is a scratch proof cars. So suppose something is scratch is there, then it won't appear. That means it won't take. So previously when you use the cell phone also, then some scratches are there. Nowadays on the screen there is no scratches because the screen is making with this advanced nanomaterials and then polymer materials they are using for scratch proof things. So these are all very exciting in day-to-day applications. Now let me go for my real content today. And then now the nanoscience, really the nanoscience is a powerful to make use of this advantages and advancements or make use of the nanoparticles. We had to design our own applications. Okay, so then now let me go for, by combining this nanomaterials or nanotechnology with highly rich energy resource in this universe is sun. So that means by make use of the sun energy and taking the advantage of nanomaterial, how we are going to resolve this environmental problem, means excess of CO2 presence in the atmosphere. So that means the renewable energy resources we all know. Then when you are looking at this particular slide, so you just look at this. This is a hydro 1:x or one time, and then comparing with this hydro power and marine is 2x, and then this is energy resources for the human beings, and then geothermal energy is 5x, and then biomass energy is 20x, and then wind energy is 200x. And what about this yellow color? Yellow color means it is sun energy. So the sun energy is 2,850x, which gives and which serves the purpose of the human needs in the form of energies. So that means, see, without sun, there is no life on the blue planet. So that means when the sun is, you just imagine if no sun is there, so no biological activity, so no photosynthesis, so nothing is there. No photosynthesis means no trees means no atmosphere. If no atmosphere means no living organism on this blue planet. So that's why our ancient people in Greek culture, the sun is a god, they are telling that. Okay, because this is the reason, I guess it is. Okay, so that means the sun energy, if you are able to utilize or use, then it serves the human needs nearly 2,850x, comparing with all other energy resources available on this blue planet. Okay, so then my task is now, I have explained you the problem, and then the solution for that problem already explained, that is a nanomaterial. And then another thing is also there. So what is that? This is energy resources which are available on this blue planet. By make use of this energy resources and then taking advantage of nanomaterials and their properties, and then we are going to design a solution for the CO2 problem and the atmosphere. So that is the thing. Now let me go for the thing is the very, very simple thing, and then whatever the problem we have, and then you just think and then you get the solution. So that means our great Indian physicist is always telling you that the great saying, or the great quotation by Sir C.V. Raman, no problem exists without solution. That is there. We know all this particular. So without solution, there is no problem. So that means where there is a problem, if you think, there is a solution. And the COVID is up to now, there is no solution for this. But all over the country, all over the world, the people are thinking it mostly by the end of this year, December, we are going to have vaccine to fight against the COVID-19. So definitely the solution may be there. But it is our ability to find the solution. Okay, so here also, the CO2 is a problem in the environment. So that is a problem. The solution is also there. So that's why this C.V. Raman is always, if you have a right question, if you have a right question, ask nature and nature will give you the solution. Just understand, C.V. Raman is always telling to his colleagues, if you have a right problem, the problem must be right. The problem should know very clearly. If you know the problem accurately, and then look at the nature and ask the nature, and the nature will give you the solution. So that is his point. So the CO2, breaking of CO2 molecule in the atmosphere, or excess of CO2 can be controlled by using advanced energy materials, and by taking the sun energy resource, we can do that. So this is possible. This is possible with nature. What nature is do, then we are also going to have that. So what nature is do, when you are looking at, just all are listening to my lecture, and then just look at for a while outside. So you are seeing outside a green environment, that is the trees are there. Now I am seeing from my room to out, there are some green plants are there. So that means how they survive. So simply, you all know it is a natural process. What is that natural process? Simply, they are taking CO2 from the environment, and then photons, sunlight from the sun, and making their food in the form of glucose, and gives out a beautiful oxygen to the human being. Understand? So that is the thing. Means what the plants do is simply they are taking CO2, and then in the presence of sunlight, and then they are making their own food, so it is nothing but glucose, and then giving out the oxygen. So that means the consume of CO2 in the presence of sunlight, and gives out and making their food, and then gives out oxygen. So this is a wonderful process. That process we call it the photosynthesis. Biology people, they know it well. Photosynthesis, this is a basic point. First, suppose if you are able to do this photosynthesis process in your laboratory, so that means excess of CO2 in the environment, you can do in addition along with the plants. But the plants, they are doing this particular excess of CO2, that means the CO2 for their food, and gives out you the oxygen. But here, if you do, that means here also simply the plants, they are breaking the CO2 molecule and making C6H6, that means food, glucose, and fructose, and then sugar formula, and then gives out water, and that means gives out wonderful oxygen to the environment. The same thing if you practice at our laboratory, that is what we call is a artificial photosynthesis. Artificial photosynthesis means the photosynthesis which we are going to practice at laboratory. But here the plants, they are doing this process for their food, but here we are doing the CO2 molecule, we are breaking it and converting into a useful chemicals that serves the purpose of many scientific applications. Okay, that is the thing. And then now let me go for how this artificial photosynthesis we are doing, but by considering the nanomaterial properties and sun energy and all. So this is six CO2 atoms, and then water in the presence of solar energy, and then the photosynthesis process will happen. C6H12O6 glucose, and 6 O2 is oxygen. This is the process. And the thing, stroma, and then, you know, thylakoid interior, and plastoquinine, and then plastocyanin. So these are all, you know, biology people, they know it very well, rather than me. So what is the real process? This is a surface equation. And then you have here, you know, deep learning. If you want to know, then you go for it. So that means how the scientists, they perform this particular reaction at laboratory. So what I did in US is this only. Artificial photosynthesis by taking the advantage of nanomaterials in the presence of sunlight. Okay. So see here is photoelectrode. This particular artificial photosynthesis, and we call it as photoelectrocatalysis. Rather, photoelectrolysis. I can say photoelectrocatalysis or artificial photosynthesis. So that means here it is a photosynthesis. You just look at this photosynthesis part, and here it is artificial photosynthesis. And the thing is the same. You take the CO2 molecule and then get this energy from the sun, and then you give some, you know, advanced materials, and the CO2 can be converted, can be breaked into some other atoms, other molecules and atoms, and by that you may get your useful chemical. So that means what is this photoelectrolysis means? It is a direct conversion of sunlight. Understand? The direct conversion of sunlight to chemical fuel with photo-generated electron and hole, that is a photoelectrolysis. Photo-generated electron and hole to drive the chemical reactions. So then I am repeating again. Direct conversion of sunlight to chemical fuel with photo-generated electron hole to drive chemical reactions. Okay, so this is the thing. And then now, so it is a very easy experiment, but you have to be take care to produce and to get the chemical fuel. Okay, so the target of the Department of Atomic Energy or Department of Energy is 25% we had to get this particular, you know, chemical fuel production from this artificial photosynthesis process. Okay, so I did these experiments with this solar fuels group at USA, United States of America, Louisville, and then he is my mentor and he is my director, and it is a Josh Sprugian, and then in his lab, novel design, and then electrocatalysis and photoelectrocatalysis and CO2 reduction. So another name for this particular artificial photosynthesis process is CO2 reduction. CO2 reduction means to reduce the CO2 molecule. If you reduce the CO2 molecule, and it can be converted into a chemical fuels and chemicals. Okay, so that's why we call it as solar fuels. So why we are calling it a solar fuel is nothing but energized chemicals which we are taking out from the CO2. And solar means by taking the advantage of solar energy, we are making the CO2 molecule into a fuel form. So that is a solar fuels. Okay, so then now come to the point, and semiconducting materials. It is one of the best nano form. If you are able to prepare these materials, and then you can do this artificial photosynthesis with the help of nanomaterials. Okay, so when you are looking at this particular slide, we have different materials here. It is a titanium dioxide, and then you know, a tungsten oxide, and then tin oxide, and then gallium phosphide, silicon carbide, cadmium sulfate, zinc oxide. I think you might have heard all these names. So why I'm telling all these names means these are all the different nanomaterials. These different nanomaterials means they have different band gaps. Just look at this. They have different band gaps. Okay, so the different band gaps means here it is silicon carbide. It is 3 electron holes, so valence band to conduction band. And you know, a wide band gap material, it is there. What is that? Tin dioxide, tin oxide. So tin oxide, you have nearly 3.8 electron holes. And then here the titanium dioxide is nearly 3. So by means, when you are looking at this different valence band to conduction band, gap is nothing but a semiconducting band gap. So different band gap materials we have in our blue planet by looking at them. And then first, suppose the visible wavelength reason, you also know it well, and the range is nearly 450 to 800. So these particular energies, if they are able to absorb these materials, and then it gives out some kind of reactions. Okay, so that's why this band gap material one has to select. Okay, and then first suppose if you select that, then what is going to be happen here? So you can reduce the CO2 into a other forms. Other forms means by giving some kind of energy. This is actually artificial photosynthesis process, which I'm going to explain. Listen carefully. Sir, how much time is left with me?
Sir, please, you can go ahead, sir. No problem.
Okay, thank you. So still half an hour is needed for me to complete. Yeah,
sure,
this,
sir. Sure, sure. Not
thank
a problem.
You. Thank you.
We can okay. Then reduce the time for interaction.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Aligarh. Okay, then CO2 photoreduction here. Photoreduction means, see here it is, CO2 molecule is there with me. Okay, first suppose if I am able to add two hydrogen, two protons and two electrons, if you are able to attach with them, then you can convert the CO2 into CO, carbon monoxide. It is a dangerous, but then we can convert it, and then we can get water out of it. And then the next CO2, if you are able to convert two protons and two electrons, and then formic acid. So one of the best chemical fuel, formic acid is a store of hydrogen energy. So formic acid is one of the best fuel. If you are able to do this reaction, it is very, very important and useful for the society also. So, but see, this particular energies are different. So that means different potentials at different potentials. If you operate, then you have different products. Like, four hydrogens and four electrons, if you are able to add to your CO2 molecule by giving some the negative 4.48 volts, then you have HCCO. Then CH2O. Okay, ethyl alcohol. And then here it is methyl alcohol and methane. So different products one can get by adding the protons and electrons to your CO2 molecule. Okay, so how can we do this? How can we add this? Means simply the process is here. You have a different band gap of semiconducting materials here, and first suppose the sun energy means, first suppose the sun is gives out a spectrum of energies. So really in our solar panels, we are using silicon solar panels, so that means 1.1 electron volts. So that means that particular range, the visible energy, if it is received by the solar panels, that particular the photons absorbed by this 0.8 to 1.1 electron volts of band gap, so that particular energy photons, if it is absorbed by the silicon, and then you are going to have nearly 10 to 15 or 18% of the photons out of 100 photons is going to convert it into electrons, that is electricity. So that, like that, here also you have different band gap materials. Once the sunlight is falls on your band gap materials, and then these materials will take that particular sun energy, and it absorbs the sun energy by the nanomaterial, and this material is going to gives out, what is that? Electrons. These electrons already generated, and this total reaction, which is going to be happen in presence of one electrolyte. So that means whenever these electrons generated out of this particular external energy received by this advanced materials, these electrons, and whenever it interacts with this electrolyte material, and there is a reduction and oxidation process will be happening at our electrode, anode and cathode. So that means this anode and cathode, by generating this proton and electrons, these continuously, if you are pump the CO2 when the process is happening of this point of time, the CO2 is going to absorbs proton and electron by applying some definite potential in between your electrode and cathode and anode. So this is the entire process. So that is the simple thing you have to understand. If you want to know the full reaction, then you have to search for some other things. The peripheral idea. So that my layman idea is means I can give you some semiconducting material is there, that a particular band gap material which are able to take some absorption from the sunlight. The sunlight absorbs some energy photons, and then it going to be excited, and while coming to the ground state, it gives you some electrons. These electrons in turn, some electrolyte solutions are there. They are interacting with that. By that, you have the electrons and protons. So it will, separated at cathode and anode, and anodic reaction and cathodic reaction. One reaction we called as oxidation, and another reaction we called reduction. And that reduction means at this particular CO2, when the protons is added and electron is added, and then you have here the formic acid and ethyl alcohol and methyl alcohol, methane, that kind of, that means when you operate a different set potential, these are the set potentials. So then you have this. So this is the layman idea. Then when you are really want to do this kind of things, then you just look at this, the chemical, electrochemical reduction. So first suppose, if you use a platinum is a material, and then you can produce from CO2 to hydrogen. So hydrogen as a fuel, So if you are make use of the platinum nanomaterial as your catalyst, the CO2 is reduced H2 evolution. And then preferably if you want to have hydrogen, then that means CO, carbon monoxide, it's a dangerous gas. Suppose if you want to generate out of this, then silver and gold, and then mixtures means the carbon mixtures means CH2, CH4 methane and ethane and other things. Copper is the best material, works as a good catalyst, photocatalyst, by using the photon energy, and copper acts as a good catalyst, and then it gives you some kind of electrons, and then oxidation and reduction process happens at anode and cathode, and by that you are generating this thing. And the zinc and tin, this is formic acid, it is a hydrogen storage material. Then this formic acid also you can do it. So understand, here I worked on this tin dioxide nanoparticle, tin nanoparticles. So by taking advantage of tin nanoparticle, I am able to produce the formic acid. So that means by how I produce the formic acid, by simply breaking the CO2 molecule. So breaking the CO2 molecule in the presence of sunlight and as well as tin dioxide nanoparticles, and then now I can able to produce formic acid. So that is my task. I did that. So see, here it is. When you look at my first slide, I put my heading is advanced nano or advanced energy materials for environmental applications. Why I am calling it is advanced nanomaterials. So the advanced nanomaterials means, we all know that nanomaterials, they have different sizes, means different different absorption strengths are there. By that, they are giving out different properties and different advantages are there. But the thing is, now if you go somewhat little bit advanced, so I have nanoparticles. So nanoparticles have some kind of advantage, and the nanowires, nanocubes. So nanoparticles mean three dimensional, two dimension, one dimension is also there. Nanowires means two dimension. If you reduce the dimension also, you have powerful energetic function is there with them. So simply the tin dioxide nanowires I prepared. So that is advancement. So preparing nanomaterials is okay. Preparation of nanomaterial is okay. Advanced means go for nanowires. So particular nanowires will perform you very well. I tested that them. And also one more advancement is also there here. When you prepare a nanomaterial is one thing, and then when you prepare nanowire is another point, and then porous thin nanowires. The porosity means the high porous thin nanowires will
Hello. Hello, Dr. Ramchandra sir.
This particular thing, within 2 days, we can prepare a material. Within 2 days. Okay. So what are these? How can we prepare? Means simply take the tin dioxide material, and then there is a plasma technique. Within 1 minute, you can prepare your nanomaterial. Just you prepare your tin material and just show them to plasma, and then when you put this particular material and this plasma will give you a nano material. So that means very within 1 minute the American people, and that means the plasma, if you have here also, they are able to prepare nano materials. Okay, so by combining this nanomaterial with potassium hydroxide 3:1 ratio, and then you heat it up for 2 to 3 minutes, that means 300 to 400 degrees, 500 degrees centigrade for 7 hours, and then some calcination with 0.1 mole hydrogen chloride presence is there, then this particular nanomaterial is going to form nanowires. So when you are going for a nanowires here, it is a nanowires, and then in the HCl presence, it is going to become a porosity. So porous nanowires. The porosity means high active sites are there, highly active sites to respond to sun energy. We prepared here porous thin nanowires. Please stop them.
Hello.
Somebody is talking.
Participants, could you please mute your audio?
Yeah. Some disturbance is there still. Ashok Kumar, Dr. Avian Ashok Kumar, please mute your mic. Dr. Avian Ashok Kumar, please mute your mic.
Yeah, I have muted him, sir.
Yes. No, he's still speaking.
Yeah, yes. I have put him on mute.
Yes. Okay. Right. So this advancement of this nanomaterial is preparing nanowires. See how beautifully we prepared nanowires. Nanowires means a plain wire, if it is there, like wire-shaped thing, the performance is okay, but when you go for this, break like thing, so this is highly porous nanoparticles. You can see this porosity under BET test is there, and also you can see this high power transmission electron microscope when you are looking at high porous grain boundaries. So when you are looking at this, these are all grain boundaries, we can call them. So this is the advancement of energy materials. So means you are going to create highly active sites of your thin nanowires. Okay, so that's why high porous grain boundary dense nanowires we prepared by simple chemical route method, and one is a plasma technique and other calcination part. Okay, And then we tested these materials with the help of whether the tin nano wire is in right phase or not. So by using XRD, we can test them. And then tin nanowires and porous nanowires also, we tested that. And then there is we couldn't find any unphase. All the porous nanowires and the nanowires, both are in the same phase. And then next, if you look at very closely, and then you can observe here 5 nanometer porous. Dr. AVN Kumar Garu, please mute or else leave the meeting room.
Yeah, I have put him on mute, sir, again.
Okay, right. Grain boundaries, here it is a 5 nanometer size. See how beautifully you are able to see the atomic size. By when you see my mentor, one of the mentor is Asa Kesensky. He is operating this transmission electron microscope there, and then visibly I have seen, and I present when we are doing this sample. Yes, so this is high porous nanowires, and then when you are zoom, then you can see this 10 nanometer size and then 5 nanometer size, highly grain boundary densities and porosity we have got. So then now let me go for the reduction reactivity. So when we go for reduction activity, so this activity you just see, this is a tin nanowire and then porous tin nanowire. So tin nanowire means blue color, the performance is, the current density is very low, 1. And then, so here porous tin nanowires means the current density is nearly 10. Why I am telling this 10 or this thing, then you can perform, I already told you some kind of energy, set potentials. So suppose if you have porous tin nanowire, the set potential you can operate in this particular length. What is the length here? -0.920. In this range, you can perform any activity. Suppose if you have, that means this is the current density is also very important here. So for that reason, porous tin nanowires are the best materials to go for photoelectrocatalysis. Okay, and then when we reduce, the thing is happen, and then what we got, it is simply nearly 80% HCO molecule, that means formic acid we got, comparing with tin nanowires, porous tin nanowires. So tin nanowires nearly 40% and porous tin nanowires double the performance we observed. Okay, so then how we do this experiment? What is the experiment procedures? So then how we utilized, experiment, the entire, this is the thing which we know it very well. And then whenever the sun rays falls on this porous tin nanowires, then what is going to be happen? So see here, it absorbs the sun radiation in the presence of some electrolyte. The CO2 is going to be break, and then which converted into HCOOH, that is a formic acid. This is the entire process. And then you can see. For this, what we did means simply I take one porous tin nanowires, I poured yet PN junction diode material. So this is P-type silicon material. Then here is PN silicon material, and the material I drop costed this tin nanowires. Why do I take here this PN junction silicon material? Means, so silicon material, you know that, so it will give you the electrons whenever this particular solar energy received by this. So that means the solar energy is received by the PN junction silicon material, and the electrons, they come out the electrons from here. Whenever this energy falls and it receives and it gives you the electrons, these electrons which are you know, interact with this highly porous sides of your tin nanoparticles. By that, you can have the oxidation and reduction reaction in the presence. By that, the CO2, which takes the two hydrogens and two electrons from here, and then you have the formic acid at other end. So this is the reaction. And then for that, see, I prepared, these are the real materials which I worked there, and I spent 6 months of time to perform this particular experiment, to understand this process and to prepare tin nanowires and porous tin nanowires, and then examining them whether they are, and the drop costing of PN. See, this is a silicon material, you know you are going to have this. And then, so then finally, there are, here it is an experiment. So see, here it is an experiment. So very simple experiment. Then one is a anodic reaction, and another is a cathodic reaction. And from here we are pumping CO2. So, and also from other side, we are sending light, because the light is here. And one is a working electrode, and another is, you know, anion and cation. So you have here the sunlight, and the sunlight whenever falls in our working electrode, and it gives you the electrons, and these electrons participated in a catalytic reaction, and this catalytic reaction will give you then automatically, in the presence of sunlight, the CO2 is going to be break and gives out a useful chemical. Then the performance of these chemicals also, I have estimated the wonderfully, I have got an excellent, nearly 30% formic acid I produced previous experiment. So see, you just look at this. What is this? Here it is HCOOH, means formic acid. And here it is hydrogen also I produced. And then a little bit of carbon monoxide. That means in addition to that, the major product, minor products also comes. And then we can test. This is by this, gas spectrometer. By using this gas spectrometer, we can test all these gases, whether the presence or not. That means Faraday efficiencies also we got. Suppose if 100 photons, if it falls, and then how many electrons will be coming out, and how many of them we utilized to run this reaction, that also we have calculated. The efficiency calculation is also there. And then nearly 55% formic acid we got it by using this experiment. Okay, now let me show you the real experiment which we did, how the artificial photosynthesis is going to be run here. So here you just look at this. Yes. See, you are all able to see this. See, the sunlight which is falls on here, and then you just look at this. Yeah, some bubbles are coming out here. So this is a working electrode. So continuously, continuously CO2 is coming, and by that, this reaction is going to give you the chemical, useful chemical, formic acid. The formic acid is deposited under bottom of the bottle, and then other hydrogen gases will be come out of these tubes. So now, once again, I am going to show you this reaction. Yeah, so this, see, the artificial light, that means sunlight which is falls on this particular chamber, and then this is my catalyst, and the nanomaterial works out here whenever it falls, and then CO2 molecules also present in this electrolyte solution, and then anion and cation, the reactions performance performed here. One is a oxygen reduction, and then another is evolution, that means CO2 reduction and oxidation. So this is the thing. It is a live video which we got, and out of this we got an excellent publication, and then the performance also we tested, and the artificial photosynthesis exactly we practiced at our laboratory at US laboratory, and then we produced nearly 52.9%, and then out of that I have got a very good publication. this publication, which comes in very beautiful journal. So that is nearly 10 impact factor. So which is the highest impact factor in my career. So Journal of Material Chemistry A, I have got it. Okay, and then this is a whole story. And then my time is over, I guess it is. And then I have got many, see some of them are talking. Please mute them, Elia Garu.
Yes, sir, yeah.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Now, so this is an excellent publication which we have got out of that work. And see, for one particular publications, I worked for 1 year. Okay. So I am the first author for this. Okay. And my mentor is also there. So an excellent Royal Society of Chemistry published this particular work. Okay. So, and then my research. So you know all, but I don't want to tell you all the things. Just I want to skip the slides. So we have a nanoscience research laboratory at Government College Autonomous Rajahmundry. So nearly 10 PhDs are produced on this crystal growth and photoluminescence and electroluminescence works. And the two MPhils are there now. Two research scholars. One is JRF is working under me, and one full-time scholar and three part-time scholars. Total 5 research scholars are working. And then whenever time permits, please come and visit our laboratory. We will show, you know, online experiments, and we have got funding from BRNS, UGC, and then it's not a great laboratory. It is okay laboratory. So that means we have a central instrumentation facilities also there in the college. And then we did some patentable work. And then I worked in a Baba Atomic Research Center, Mumbai, and electroluminescence by giving a small amount of, you know, 2 to 3 volts of energy. So we are able to give you blue light. So the blue light is producing blue light by taking the advantage of nanomaterials is one of the challenge. We did this, and nearly 8 PhDs produced on this particular nanomaterials and photo and electroluminescence projects. And then some crystal growth work is also there in my college. And then when you come, I will show you. And this is my group in the US. And the US, they've given MOU to my college. I have a facility to go there and to do some kind of novel ideas with them. And highest impact factors and some, you know, collaborations is there for the laboratory. And then we did, national level refresher courses also there. A government college, refresher courses only nowadays, you know, webinars. So previously refresher courses can be conducted by only universities, but whereas government colleges also can conduct a national level refresher course, the valid UGC refresher course in association with Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, I did this particular work. And then many things, startups and this thing, scholars, publications, impact factors, citations, H-index, I-index, everything is there for my laboratory and my college. So because of my research efforts and my colleagues also, and my research scholars also. So suppose, what I want to tell you is, if you really have a potential, if you really devote your time towards the research, definitely you can do wonders. These are all the things which we have got in my laboratory. These are all the crystals we grown in my lab. And I have many more collaboration across the country and as well as internationally. And then we published papers, and Raman Fellow is one of the greatest credentials in my life. And then I thank the Commissionerate of College Education, who provides me the opportunity to go US and to carry out my research on sabbatical leave. So dear friends, sabbatical leave is one option is there. You can get your salary here, and there 2 lakh rupees for this Raman Fellowship each and every month in US. That also you can get. Both benefits are there if you go for sabbatical leave. That facility is there for all the government degree college lectures that I utilized it. Okay. So I did neat in hydrogen and oxygen ga vibhajinche prakriya shikaram. So that means we are purchasing this particular, you know, catalysis, photocatalysis unit, and we are planning it. So I'm always telling you, this is my motivation. Whenever I go, I would like to tell you this. 1 to the power of 365 is always 1. 1.01 to the power of 365 is 37.7, your pass. Means, suppose, whatever you are appointed a lecturer means your duty is lecturing, means you have to teach to the graduate students. So that is your duty. Undoubtedly, you are doing it because we are all passionate to select this profession towards the teaching activity. But if you only confine to the teaching activity, the name and fame, it won't come. But so that means multidisciplinary, the national education policies and all, they are stressing on multidisciplinary. There is no science, there is no art stream. Science students can take the arts and art students can take the science, and science they all the take the commerce. And so whatever it is, you enter in with one degree and one degree on one domain, you come up with another domain. See, recently I came across in Singapore University, one student has joined as a civil engineer, and after 1 year he don't want to do and continue as a civil engineer, and he converted his degree into a BA economics, and then he came with a degree BA economics. That means multiple entry and multiple exit and is there, and at the same time the science students 3 years degree and 4 years degree is there. 3 years degree for just degree, and 4 years degree is looking for research opportunity. When go for the 4 years degree means that is a research degree, so go for another 1 year, MSc is completed, and they are perfectly fit for the, that means honors program, perfectly fit for the research. Suppose if you offer in your college, if you offer the research degree, you need to have some research exposure, you are able to do some research, and you have to publish some papers and get some connections across the country and other countries also. So that is the thing. For all this, you have to do some extra time. You have to dedicate your time extra, then only you will be flourished. So this is the end of my talk. I hope you all like it. Any questions, I am ready to answer. Thank you for providing the opportunity. Once again, I thank to the organizers. Thank
sir,
you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for that wonderful presentation.
Sir.
You have explained the complete work, what you have taken up, what you have done in USA.
Yes, sir.
That's a wonderful presentation. You have explained the nanotechnology behind breaking CO2 molecule.
Yes.
Artificial photosynthesis and solar fuels and everything you covered, what you have done in USA. We shall take just one or two questions. Already we are running short of time. Here is one question, sir.
Yes,
sir. May I ask you, sir? I am Balaya, Government Degree College.
Yes. Sir. Yeah.
Sir.
You can.
Indian government has launched the in 2007.
Yeah.
Nanoscience and Technology Mission, sir. In this mission, sir, India has allowed the public partnership in this field, sir.
Okay.
Already the nanotechnology has come into the play in different fields, like as you mentioned, energy, water purification, I mean water supply, agriculture, environment,
yes.
ICT, and medicine and healthcare, sir.
Yes,
at
sir.
the